Welcome to today's Debrief Facebook Live, brought to you by 3Mobile. And fittingly, we're going to be talking about how apps have transformed our romantic lives. I am joined by Alex Fox.
Hello.
Journalist and sex educator.
Indeed, and percher on sofas shaped like numericals, it would appear.
Indeed. And what is your current sort of romantic status?
It has a big Riddler question mark over the top of it. I am beginning to get to know somebody who actually lives in a different country to me, who is utterly luscious, but we shall see how that pans out. But in my day-to-day life, I get to hear a lot about other people's romantic endeavours and what they're doing or not doing with their genitals, more than I actually get to do a heck of a lot with mine. So I have a lot of other people's stories that, with their permission, I can share.
We look forward to hearing them. I'm also joined by Nellie Eden.
Hi.
Debrief dating columnist.
I know, quite a title.
Big title.
Big title. I've done a lot of dating in my time, especially over the last 5 years. And obviously that landscape has changed really rapidly. I'm concerned about how women are changing that too. So I guess that's what I do for the debrief mainly, yeah.
So lots to talk about.
Lots and lots to talk about.
And Sophie Wilkinson.
Hello.
Hi. Editor at large of the Debrief.
Yes. Yeah.
And in a long distance relationship,
yes.
I think you'll mind me saying.
Yes, no, that's absolutely fine. Like there's no secrecy about that. We've been together for 3 years. Although we haven't actually spent much of that time.
Where does she live?
Together. She lives in Cardiff.
So yeah. It is you're in London.
It is, yeah. There was a point where she lives in Bristol, but anyway, yeah, she's now back home in Cardiff and I'm very much in London.
Depends how it goes. Yeah. So let's kick off by talking about long distance relationships. I think that's a really obvious area where tech and having, you know, the ability to communicate through your phone, through apps, has really transformed long distance relationships. I mean, I was in one when I was 18.
Yeah, 18, I think I was in one when I came out of university as well. But mobile phones weren't really a thing then, so it was more a matter of Skype.
How
yeah.
old are
She's
you?
Like, I mean, hey, seriously, you didn't have iPhones.
No, but mobile phones definitely were a thing, but it's just the apps and the
technology.
Of accessibility. I mean, you'd get one text that would cost 12p to send.
And, yeah. And like, I mean, Skype is mega stressful because the signal and the kind of, it didn't
there
sound.
There is something about Skype and also about FaceTime is that you can look, like me and my girlfriend used to FaceTime and then we just stopped doing it because we'd always argue, because I think there is something about the psychology of your eyes just quite not being at one another, and also you end up just looking at yourself and
you
like
do.
Putting stupid faces
you
and
do.
Faces off the other person, and then can we swear?
Is that right? Maybe
I'll try not to.
That's okay.
All
do,
right, sorry,
that's okay.
That.
You are live on Facebook.
Oh,
please
course,
do not swear.
Okay.
So with a long distance relationship, so mine failed, and I think it was a lack of like mobile tech, apart from like really crap Skype.
Yeah, no. I think I switched it to text because I wanted to have my phone not on silent anymore, because I would get so many messages from her and vice versa that my phone would constantly be going off, so I just have it on silent, which meant that I was constantly looking at it. And I think that is the big problem about a long distance relationship. We're on the phone to each other for probably about an hour each night, and I think a lot of my friends probably think that I'm not online that much anymore, but actually I am. It's just because I am spending a lot of time with her but not with her at the same time. So yeah.
One interpretation of your move from FaceTime to Messenger to text might actually be that your understanding of each other, you and your partner, is really deep, because some people find it notoriously difficult to express their emotions just through words alone. Whereas if you're able to make that function so well, that is a good indicator that the two of you connect really nicely. I think.
How much do I pay you for that? That was really, really good insight, and
the
it made
stack
me feel.
Used fivers.
It made me feel really
official.
Good.
The old fivers, not the new ones.
Yeah. I like the new fivers.
I like the new fivers, but that is a whole other. I mean, they are really good, but we're
going off on a tangent. Yeah.
But to Sophie's point, I think different platforms resonate differently for everybody. I think if in a kind of heterosexual sense, if a guy that you don't know that well slides into your DMs, it like only ever means one thing.
Yes.
It's not for a sort of work favor normally,
right? Yeah, no, that's yeah.
Well, it might be disguised as a work favor.
Yeah, no, definitely it's disguised for sure.
Do you
like
ever find
thinly
it really hard to differentiate between whether someone is asking you for a work favor or wants to meet up to talk about something professional, or whether it's something more squelchy and squishy?
I do sometimes, and I'm in a long term relationship, so I'm like definitely not on the market. But occasionally I do get a DM and I'll show it to my boyfriend and be like, what do you think this is?
Better, you better.
Yeah, and he's like, do not respond.
Right.
But also,
but if somebody messaged me on Facebook, I'd be like, this is work.
Yeah, Facebook work, Instagram, I'd think that was...
Instagram seems really, really private in a way. Because you feel as if there's something like you've got the public bit and then those private messages are just completely hidden. Yeah, exactly. Because you see them on a completely different screen to where you see Facebook messages. Mm-hmm. So when you get a Facebook message, you've got the rest of your timeline there and it feels almost as if there's a panoply.
What about Twitter DMs? That's always work, right?
I just
That's how I met her.
Yeah. I've started relationships from Twitter DMs.
Yeah.
I actually have had one relationship through Twitter DM too,
Was it just on Twitter DM or did it happen IRL? Your internet boyfriend.
It happened IRL, yeah.
That's sweet.
Has anyone ever had a purely online partner?
I have definitely been speaking to guys on Instagram for maybe like 6-7 months before I've met them.
But have you been in the relationship?
No.
Okay.
I think
that's quite an intense.
I definitely did that when I was like 13, 14, maybe like until I was 16 or something.
Yeah, but that's. Yeah. I think there's a reason for that, which now.
Yeah.
27.
I'm 29, actually.
Pardon me, sorry.
No, that's all right. Thank you.
That's okay.
Thank you.
What we're touching on is really interesting because it's the behaviour that has evolved as the tech we use to communicate has evolved. And I think, so we're all of a similar age. We're all millennials. And I remember...
By the skin of my teeth.
Clinging
onto millennial status.
But I think, from the age of 16 to now, as I approach 30... the apps have evolved, the technology has evolved, and dating looks completely different to how it used to look. And I think the way people behave has changed slightly. Obviously, it's the same behaviour that you were always seeing. Like, you could always get dumped. But I think the way people do things is
yeah, you can get dumped in, like, sort of pretty much three different ways. Somebody can either tell you, they can ignore you, or they can make excuses until you stop asking. And it's really rare for somebody just to say, I don't want to go on another date with you.
So we're talking about ghosting and some other things that Nelly's written about for us. Yeah. Zombieing. We've also talked about breadcrumbing.
Yeah.
All of these terms that you have to go to Urban Dictionary to look up.
Yeah.
Which one do you think is the worst?
I think breadcrumbing is particularly manipulative.
Yeah.
Leading someone on without intention of ever actually following through.
It's just keeping someone warm with little
communication.
Like,
yeah.
Well, I'll take any carb I can, to be honest.
Who wants to get?
Carb to carb. I do wonder whether sometimes we interpret these behaviours very negatively because we're quite cynical about dating, particularly with regards to technology, when in fact, in real life, someone might be, maybe they've had a bad week and been out of contact because something's happening in their life that requires their attention,
Yeah, I think we're definitely paranoid.
And then they come back and try and get in contact. Or perhaps they're trying to give their full attention to someone they're tentatively dating, and then that doesn't work out. So they come back to people and try and warm things up again. I don't think it's always as evil as it's sometimes interpreted to be.
Why do you think it? Because we are vulnerable when we're dating, and you're vulnerable in a relationship in many ways. You make yourself emotionally vulnerable. So do you think we tend to see things as a negative or as a slight on us if we do get rejected? And it feels more immediate now because...
Yeah, rejection's never feels good. And now you can be rejected in all manner of ways.
Mm.
So you're constantly reading into things to see if there's rejection in there, I think. I definitely have sat with friends who've had a really kind of mundane text come through. And we sit there and decide whether they're being rejected or not. And it's this kind of like weird new process of kind of, most of the time it's not Morse code. It's like, just you don't always have to read between the lines. But I think everybody kind of has their backup. There's a sense of paranoia that everybody's looking for something better. So like, dump or be dumped is a kind of default position sometimes.
I guess the negative is what you don't get over message unless it's FaceTime is body language. So you might not see that someone is genuinely not feeling great about rejecting you.
Yeah.
And it's very easy to interpret a message in a number of ways. But I guess the positive is when I was single, you can meet so many more people now than you used to be able to. And that is a positive.
Yeah. For the last 5 years I've been single and you could go on a date every night if you wanted to. I'm not just talking about myself, anybody. And it's really, really good fun, don't you laugh? It's really
No, it's just that it was the anybody thing, but yeah, carry on.
You could.
I think any straight girl probably could, I think. I think the ways that guys and girls use online apps are quite different. But finish your point, please.
Well, it was just really good fun. Like, it can be really, really good fun. Sure. I'd never dated so many people in my life. And you kind of get to a point where you have enough rejection that it doesn't feel like rejection anymore. And vice versa, you have to like be very, it's made me much more vigilant about the way I treat other people. I think it's probably made me a nicer friend and a more compassionate dater. But it took 3 years of sort of shitty behavior, probably.
I think it's interesting because obviously apps like Tinder, Happn, Bumble, whatever, or your DMs are meant to lead to a meeting in real life and then a real life relationship.
Mm-hmm.
But quite often, in my experience, it would never get to the real life meeting and you'd have this is what I meant by a kind of online relationship. There are a few people who I just saw on WhatsApp for months.
There's like nothing, I love nothing more than like walking down Kingsley Road and like clocking a boy's face and being like, where do I know you from? I'm like, oh yeah, we DM for 3 months. Cool, we never met. Yeah, like, you look worse in real life. Cool, and then you like get on with your day.
But that wasn't necessarily so different when we were growing up. And I'd be interested to know what Debrief readers think of this as well, because like MSN, who remembers MSN?
Yeah,
I wasn't allowed it.
You weren't allowed it.
Probably, this is a whole sphere of pop culture probably reference
good.
I don't get.
Yeah, probably
but
good.
I'm showing my age here because I'm nearly 35 and I didn't have the internet at home. I had my first mobile phone as a student when I went to uni and it had Snake on it. And I remember if you went over a certain number of characters on a text, you got charged another 12p.
Yeah.
So
you
have to fill up that next text.
Yeah. I remember thinking very, very
carefully.
I'll
text you from my dad's phone.
Yeah.
Text me back.
Yeah. I remember the green screen lighting up at night, me getting all excited that my boyfriend, my then boyfriend, had texted me. But yeah, I never really had one of those MSN Messenger relationships.
I came to romance really late, partly because I had a twin brother and I didn't have MSN. I was like busy on Neopets while you were all.
What was your twin?
What? I know.
What's your twin brother got to do with it?
I mean, wait. Because we were at school together, so I was like,
all of
Max wouldn't resent me saying this, is, you know, dating was not an option for me while he was around.
Aww. Oh, so he was really protective.
I imagine some
protective doesn't cover
style
it.
Style thing here. Where
so and then at home I was equally cock blocked by my mum not letting us have access to the internet. So I just, until I was sort of, I still feel relatively new to dating people through technology. I don't find it natural. I don't claim to have like assimilated to it. I don't think it's fun. I would always prefer to meet someone in person, but that's rare.
I think for the most part I agree, but I did have some really positive experiences where I met people who I would never have met. And it wasn't meant to be, but I'm really glad that they were in my life for a period, and we would not have met if it wasn't for the geolocator of Tinder.
Yeah.
I had two pretty serious relationships off the only two real Tinder dates I went on. And we have no friends in common. It's like the 90s. Like, I don't know where they are now. I don't know.
You can't trust them.
We just never did. We never like followed each other on social media, and we don't go to the same places. Like, you know, and that's, It was easier when things finished that it just finished like that. Mm. Unless, I don't know if they know where I am or what I'm doing, but I don't know where they are. But they were really profound relationships.
Right now.
Yeah, hi.
But when I was growing up, I had access to the internet that my mum was definitely, she didn't want me to have that level. But in retrospect, actually, the kind of the IRL boys at my school and around my school and stuff, I definitely feel like the internet might have actually been safer for me at some points as well. Mm. And also figuring out my sexuality, it was really, really important. But I did things like I catfished people, like people that I would never ever meet, but I just pretended to be completely different people, mainly boys, in order to kind of legitimize my feelings and to make myself feel normal. Because if I could hide behind a boy, then I could, you know, then my relationship could be a heterosexual one online and stuff. And so I had, you know, and a few of them, you know, it was a kind of brief period of doing that, a very brief period. But then there was like this longer online relationship, and there was a point where we were potentially going to meet, and then her parents kind of intervened. And actually, I'm kind of
the catfishing
really
thing.
Grateful of that.
It is an important thing.
Yeah,
we all do that to an extent. We've all performing ourselves more than ever before. So the pressure to match up with your internet self and real self, I think, is a new...
It's like what Alex is saying about the messages being... bearing no relation to the person in real life. We all present the very best version of ourselves when we're dating online.
Yeah, it's the only way to make it work. You can't give people like your worst self and expect them to be interested.
Is that so different to going on a night out and meeting someone in the club?
No, we've always done that. There is a tendency as well to kind of pigeonhole men in these kind of digital dating landscapes as window shoppers or... you know, kind of game players, and that they hold all the control, all the power, and that it's enabled them to treat women in a particular way. But I always feel defensive of that. It feels too kind of swathingly negative.
And not all men are like that.
Yeah,
of course. I mean, I haven't tried to date one in a while, so I wouldn't really know.
It's interesting. Like, apps like Bumble. I'm interested to know what you think, Alex, because obviously you hear from a lot of different people about their experiences. Like dating and sex, and what the kind of apps that people feel the most positively about are. Because Bumble, I mean, is, I'm sure we've all either used it or know what it is.
I can say that I never have. And I say that as someone who, I'm still on dating apps, just for lulz and for like when I go traveling
research.
And stuff.
Work.
For research. Yeah. Not even, no, just to like, just, and also just to, you know, kind of just to window shop, definitely window shop. I'm probably worse than most blokes that I'm talking about. But yeah, anyway, I've never used Bumble, well, but Bumble... I'm still on loads of them. I'm not on Raya
shame
though.
On you.
That's a real shame.
Raya said I wasn't important enough to go on. I couldn't even write about
it. If anyone that does not know what Raya is, can you explain what Raya is?
Yeah, Raya is one of the so-called elite dating apps where you have to be screened and approved before you're able to have a profile on there. In particular, Raya looks at your social media presence. I was deemed not to be important enough on the internet. I don't know. I think I didn't have enough Instagram followers or didn't give enough shit, I don't think. But there are a few others as well. There's one called The Inner Circle.
One called The League.
Oh, yeah, there's The League.
Oh, yeah, The League let me in immediately.
Did they?
I think The League, basically, if you've got an MA, you can... No, I'm just saying.
An MA?
I'm lucky enough to have been very well educated, and they just let you in.
So it's about...
It's not even about intelligence. I think it might also be because I went to Exeter University as well, which is very, like... upper middle class, essentially. Very
that's such a polite way.
Yeah, no, I'm being diplomatic.
I think some of these dating apps, the initial impression you might get of them is that they're rather snobby and that they're for people who are looking for folks who are well off or who are perhaps making swathing dismissals of anyone they see as not upper class enough for them or whatnot. But I think in some cases they actually help to weed out the time wasters or the fake profiles, you know,
And also, like, you know, you can presume that a certain type of person's going to be active on Raya. And if you don't want to date them, then it's probably better that you're not on there. It's kind of status conscious.
And I guess it's a choice. You can choose to use that app. Yeah. Or you can choose to go on Tinder and see all of the people out there who you would never cross paths with knowingly in a day.
Yeah, I think that's key. You have to be in a kind of positive state of mind. I don't think you can go into these things feeling victimized, because they can be extremely negatively impactful on your mental health. They're strenuous and they can be exhausting. They can also be really, really fun. And I don't think there's anything wrong with dating more people. I have to say that. I think it's never been a better time to, you know.
Well, it's an interesting stat that while marriage has slowed down a bit for our generation, it looks like divorce rates are also slowing down. Like, we're getting married later, and obviously time will tell, the proof will be in the pudding. But will we stay together because we didn't get married so young? Mm. We had
less impetus to settle.
Yeah, and we had access to trying loads of different things, dating different people, and then working out what it was actually... you know, that we're
crystallizing what we really want and finding someone who might be a really good match for us. I think as well, we're of a generation who've seen, many of us have seen our parents divorce, in my case twice, although mum's getting married again next week to the wonderful one, yes, which is brilliant. But I wonder whether a lot of people of our age are more careful and more cautious about marriage because they have seen it go wrong.
Yeah, I mean, my parents are separated and I absolutely feel like that. It's definitely shaped the way I make decisions about relationships. I think positively, ultimately, I am quite cautious, but also I've been very careful before making big commitments and decisions because I want to be sure. And I think that is partly because you can meet different people and the grass is always greener, right? Yeah. That's a that's human nature.
Yeah.
But you go to that grass and up close it's a bit patchy and you realise that the allure of that grass is not.
Or you'd rather have sand.
Or pebbles.
Yeah.
I mean, let's extend that metaphor. Like,
well, actually, this is very relevant. You asked what apps people tell me they have positive experiences with. I speak to a lot of folk who have quite specific sexual interests and fetishes. But even outside of that group, a lot of people tell me they really like OkCupid because it requires them to fill out sometimes quite extensive questionnaires about who they are and what they're looking for in people. So it then the partners that they're potentially matched with are a much better fit for them. And I think OkCupid is interesting as well in that it, perhaps more so than any of the other apps we've talked about so far or dating sites, it's very reflective of the current outlook, socially, cultural outlook. Things like the ability to classify your sexuality as things like sapiosexual, so finding someone interesting to you if you find that there's an intellectual
connection.
You hate that term.
No.
It's very
what divisive. I find really interesting, Sean Fay, who's
from the internet.
From the internet. She was saying that you see people call themselves sapiosexual online on certain sites, and they're not saying it as in I'm really stupid and I'm really attracted to people that are really, really smart. It's basically a way of saying I'm really, really smart and I only want to date another smart person. Nobody says it because they're thick and they want to be overpowered by someone mentally genuinely overpowered.
Although I'm sure there is that fetish.
Do you think so?
Yeah.
I'm sure that exists, but I think it's a euphemism.
For saying I'm really smart.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
But I think the proliferation of all these different terms now and I'm not saying that the behaviour wasn't always there, but one thing I think is really positive is that we now can identify certain things and then find other people who also identify that way.
It can be really helpful.
I'm a romantic at heart, right? So whenever I see these messages, I'm like, oh, maybe if you were a different person, I was a different person, this would be the most romantic story ever. But no, it is just a bit creepy. Like last year when I was doing all of the Debriefs renting campaign stuff, doing a lot of TV appearances, which I still do from time to
Congratulations, by the way.
Oh, thanks.
Had a really great impact.
Oh, thanks. Nice one. That's really nice to hear. And also, like, still so much to do. But every time I would go on the news, my other inbox would fill up, mostly men, with people saying things like, oh, I really want to meet someone like you.
I've had the opposite. I've had, like, shut up and get back into the kitchen.
I've had that too.
I like these sandwiches.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think I'd say it's like 70-30. It's 70% shut up.
Yeah.
30, and you don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Go home and like have some children and don't speak again.
Yeah.
Go home to your rented property.
Yeah, go home to your rented property that you can't afford.
Children.
Yeah. But 30% you know, I would love to meet someone like you. And I'm like, oh, you're not for me. And I have a boyfriend. But is this the new like serendipity? Like in my heart, I'm like, I really want those romantic stories to come true online. I really do. There must be someone out there for whom that has happened. I really want to believe that it can be like a Disney fairy tale.
The whole idea of journalists and their subjects falling in love. Hadley Freeman wrote a piece about how this is such a familiar trope in loads of films, and we're told that people always end up. I think it was about is it called Trainwreck? The one with the one with Amy Schumer in
Trainwreck.
Trainwreck. Yeah, and sorry,
Trainwreck. Car crash.
Something
any of these
like that,
could
something
describe
like that.
My previous.
But anyway, it was
one of them.
She falls in love with the subject that she interviews, and actually that doesn't really happen. And I think you know it's not just social media that propagates myths about the way that people fall in love and the way that people get together. The whole meet cute happens in so many different ways, and there are so many different problematic permutations.
I guess what came first, the meet cute in film or the meet cute in real life? Yeah. I'm thinking of The Holiday now with Kate Winslet.
Oh yeah. I'm thinking about
Roman Holiday.
Sounds like a sweet penis. Meat is so cute.
Puts me off.
But that's where my head goes.
I was thinking about barbecue. So
oh God.
We're all in very different places.
I don't think I'm particularly romantic. I don't think I want to be romance like that. I've not had experiences where that's happened in real life, but I certainly look at other friends, like very practical, happy relationships, and have felt lonelier for it. And again, technology is like both great and negative for that, I think.
But on that, I think we've touched a bit on the behaviours that have been being given labels. I think they probably always existed, like I was going to call it biscuiting, but no, breadcrumbing. And cushioning is something you've written about first, Nelly. And I'm interested to know what you think.
Tell me about cushioning. What's the Urban Dictionary definition?
Cushioning is the idea that you kind of stay in touch with different people who give you different things and maybe prop you up a bit.
Oh my God.
If you're feeling lonely, you know, if you're like, I don't know, Sunday, feeling, you know, crap after. Yeah, I was going to say come down. You know, and you cushion that.
Yeah, I definitely speak to lots of different people for lots of different reasons. I think I include that to friendships as well.
Yeah.
I think before I was in this relationship, I was really, really very single and like
very, very single.
No, I was seeing different people, but I would kind of spin lots of different plates, and I would have these ongoing kind of intermittent relationships that weren't quite relationships, and I was seeing girls who actually girls who weren't comfortable they were women and they weren't comfortable being out of the closet to anyone but me and a few other people, and so we would have these kind of secret relationships that were only really facilitated by technology. But those, I don't necessarily think those were good relationships, but I can't really say whether technology got me into them or whether it's whether that just could have happened anyway.
I think it's interesting that you've spoken about the positive role that tech has played in coming out and in exploring that as well. I think that it's not a million miles off my experiences of trying things out on MSN chat with guys.
Yeah, you kind of test the boundaries.
But I think it is a different thing. Mm. It's obviously played a very particular role for you.
Well, I was online on dating sites way too early. There was something called Face Party, which wasn't meant to be a dating site, which definitely, you'll remember that. And there was this dominatrix that would give kind of agony aunt advice every week, and it was so problematic, but I was addicted to reading that, and that kind of reeled me in. And then I went on Gaydar Girls, and I don't know whether it still exists, but it definitely existed a few years ago, and it still looked very 1.0. It was very, very like prehistoric in its look. But I was talking to this girl, and we would kind of have this ongoing conversation all the time. Maybe we'd meet up, maybe we wouldn't meet up, and we started texting and stuff. And then it turns out she's like one of my really, really good friends now. And that's something that happens a lot in girl-on-girl dating.
I'm curious about that, because I suppose as a heterosexual woman who likes to date men, your main preoccupation when you meet somebody is like, do they just want to have sex, or are they looking for something more? With you, is there a different kind of set of concerns?
I think people, the dating behaviours, you'd expect, so broadly, when men are on dating apps alone, when it's something like Grindr, it is just hookup related. It's about meeting as many times as possible, and you know, it is about racking things up, and that is the way that Grindr is. And a lot of gay men and a lot of queer men complain about Grindr and the way it's run and the way it works, and they've got a lot of gripes about it, but that is the kind of the monolith. Conversely, there's not kind of one site. There's an app called Her, which is a kind of women and non-binary, and they've also been a lot more inclusive to people who aren't necessarily assigned female at birth as well to be in there, and they also let trans men in, and trans men aren't necessarily appreciated on Grindr. So there is this kind of
it's fascinating that apps become shaped by the communities that sign up exactly. more than
but
they
what happens is that when girls meet each other, if they don't get on, like, if they don't find each other sexually attractive, they still end up kind of being friends.
Related, but separate. I think this does speak to something that I think happens with female friendships. And I'm not afraid to say that actually two of the people on this sofa, I think we became friends because of the internet.
Oh my gosh, I'm about to meet somebody this afternoon who's a mum in Chicago that I've had an internet friendship with for 3 years. And I can't wait.
That's amazing. Friends that I have two groups of friends, people I've met in real life through meeting on the internet, and people who I consider really dear friends who I have never actually met in person, who my relationships with them are purely digital, and I still really cherish them. Just returning slightly to what you said, Sophie, about if women who have sex with women meet each other via an app or something and don't romantically gel, they might still become friends. I wish more heterosexual people would do that.
100%.
Because there's this horrible idea of being friend-zoned, meaning completely rejected, and that's kind of the booby prize and a horrible thing to happen to you.
And the idea that you get that as a punishment for being a nice person which I don't think.
In fact, friendship is being friends with someone, saying, well, this isn't going to work romantically,
glad we met and I would like to have you in my life.
But people say that and so often don't mean it. I definitely have a sense of, like, I've been in the same room as people who have rejected me or not been interested in seeing me, and the only feeling I feel is like shame, and I don't want to talk to them. I don't want them to feel like I'm in a place where I've come because they might be there. It's like, it's very difficult. The overriding sense is that somebody saying, you know, I'd really like to be friends with you, it really, most of the time, it doesn't mean that.
Yeah, sometimes.
And I've done that too.
Yeah.
I know that because I do that.
I said it once and I really meant it.
Yeah,
this person not want to be my friend.
Oh, that's a shame.
I have a few people that I have managed to claw it back after, you know, 3 or 4 months of not talking to each other, where I've reached out again or I've bumped into them and you buy them a drink and then, you know, ask them about who they're dating or whatever, and you kind of get back up to a point. But having a kind of deep friendship with those people is something that has eluded me. Mm. I can't speak for other people.
I've had a perhaps unusual experience recently in that I met somebody through Twitter. We dated for a summer and had a lovely time, but they were still quite attached to an ex-partner who they eventually went back to, and I think that was the right thing. We stayed friends over time, even though I did find that difficult at first, because I would have wanted something more from the relationship that wasn't available. But I accepted that friendship wasn't the booby prize, it was the right thing in that scenario. They then suggested to me that I might want to go on a date with their good friend, which at first I took really badly. I thought, oh, you know, you've rejected me, you don't want me, so you're passing me over to the second best thing or whatever. But then once I'd calmed down, I thought, well, this is someone I really liked, and they're telling me there's someone that they really like who I might also really like. And I did go on a date and had a great time.
Yeah, we still see that friend of friend endorsement. Yeah. That's still that kind of, you know, 6 degrees of separation. Like, Ruby Rose is definitely not that far away, right? No. But I still definitely seek that out. You know, if I find somebody I don't really use dating apps anymore, but if I mean, obviously I'm seeing somebody, but caveat, but if I was looking for somebody, I'd normally go for somebody that had at least had friends in common. That still stands to be a kind of good litmus test.
I wish we could hook up former flames with friends. I tried to do that as well. And it was a guy who I went on a few dates with. Nothing ever really happened apart from the dates. We had a really nice time. Then I got back together with my long-term boyfriend who I had been on a break with. And a few months later, I texted him and was like, you should date my friend.
This is the flip side of my scenario.
He was not into it. And I wish we could, maybe.
I'm seeing someone that was seeing my friend. And he was not very nice to my friend.
Oh, that's interesting.
And it's just kind of...
Has he learned?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's a good thing. I think we should give people
space. Somebody else, and all three of us would like go for a drink. For a moment, it was tense, yeah.
I think that's something interesting about the fact that we do so much of our interacting online now as well, is that if you do something bad or you say something bad, which I have done, there are things I've done I'm not proud of, and I'm not
a human.
Yeah, I'd like to know how many of my texts have been screenshotted.
Yeah, that's exactly.
Really weird.
When how many of those screenshots are still out there? And I would apologise for things I've said now, but it can be captured permanently and held onto as a kind of a signpost of this is the sort of person that person is. But you might, like we were saying earlier, be having a bad day, or maybe you were going through a bad breakup.
Yeah, yeah. But if you've wronged me, I've got a screenshot of your text.
So that neatly segues into something else I really want to talk to you guys about, which is there is a side of online dating and online relationships that can turn really sour. And I think it is an issue that's getting bigger and bigger, where, I mean, a high profile case recently is Rob Kardashian sharing explicit images of Black China. Picture of the two of them together there. But also sexting, which, you know, we all do, I think.
Uh-huh.
When you're sharing those images in good faith and then they are used against you, that's a really difficult thing. It actually happened to me once where I sent someone an image who I didn't really know. that well, but you still think that there's a code of conduct. And I actually saw them in a local pub where I was showing the image to the people on the table next to me. This was a few years, this was about 6 years ago. And I remember just being so horrified and felt so shamed and really, really betrayed as well. But what do you think, Alex? Because, I mean, you must come across this a lot.
I actually had a personal experience where, going to have to be careful about how I speak about this. I went home with someone after a few dates who I had met through work. I was very flattered by their interests and very excited to be there and feeling quite hedonistic that night. It was a what the hell kind of evening. I was having a great time with them, or so I thought, until I looked up to find that I was being filmed without my permission. And I have never known fear quite like that. And actually, this was many years ago. And I think the way I would react now as an older, more empowered person would be very different. I would be shutting that camera right down. I would be making sure that I had the film, and I would be... I wouldn't be holding back in my disapproval of that scenario. The way I did react actually has taught me a lot about what people do when they are afraid, because he said, oh, but you look so great. I just want to appreciate, this is just for me. I just want to appreciate this for myself. And I felt so terrified by what he might do with this footage. This was prior to revenge porn acts being brought into law.
2015, when revenge porn was made illegal in the UK.
Yeah, although I still think that that doesn't solve the issue, because often by the time it's been brought to court, the damage has already been done emotionally and perhaps to your career and all sorts. The way I acted after that was to try and be as nice to that person as I possibly could, because I was so terrified of what he might do. He actually continued to speak to me on and off for years, and recently I felt confident enough to say to him, look, I can't continue this small talk with you until I make it clear to you how damaging that experience was, and I need to know whether that footage still exists. I didn't even know how much had been captured. I don't know what he has or what I knew so little. I felt very out of control. He actually promised me that he had destroyed it the next day. He had brothers, younger brothers, and he said he didn't want them to see it by accident or something. But we had a long talk about how he's a little younger than me, and he'd basically grown up with a phone in his hand. He was a good-looking man who most people didn't say no to and were very excited, like me, to be in his presence, because he was a hot thing at the time. And I think that I believe that he genuinely hadn't really thought that he was doing anything wrong, because what he used to ask consent for had become second nature to the point where he had forgotten the way these things should go.
I think this is something that does trouble me. For all the positive things about what we can now do with mobile technology, because it is second nature,
people forget to ask for consent. That's the best case scenario, that they've forgotten.
Yeah, or if you're going through a breakup and you have a big following like Rob Kardashian, or even a small following, you might, in a moment of bad judgment and rage or pain, do something that could, A, be illegal, but B, perhaps more importantly, cause someone serious damage.
It happens to men too. I remember somebody I was working with, somebody hacked onto his Instagram and shared a really awful picture, and we still talk about it. And he's a very senior creative director somewhere. So, not to be taken lightly.
Yeah, I think we've got, there's a real big miasma of just gross stuff associated with sexting. Now, the thing is, with me, whenever people say sexting, I think about describing something like verbally and using words, which I think is a really, really nice way of, you know, creating erotica. Even like I was doing that when I was about 16, 17, and I thought it was, that was maybe a bit younger as well, which, you know, but it was a way of prodding at curiosities and talking about things and getting excited about things and using language, and I love that. But sexting now is a lot of pictures, and I have to say, me and my girlfriend, because I was I was telling her that I was on this because I wanted to just get her okay on certain things, and I think I haven't even pushed hard enough on that. But but she, we haven't sent each other like descriptive sexts in about a year. But I mean, I started going to the gym, so I started sending her pictures of me like just naked pictures, like mainly to not even about sexuality, just about like the fact
abs.
That I'd abs, yeah, and all of that. And I accidentally I basically had it as a little preview on a picture. Luckily I was wearing a bit of clothes, and then a friend was like zoomed in and was like lol at that. So I effectively shared that myself. But yeah, I've definitely had previous relationships, and also online things where, like, I mean, really hazy, there's hazy webcam footage of me somewhere, and there's an ex who's definitely got pictures of me when I was just 18 and stuff. And I would love to say that, I wouldn't love to say it, but it would be very simple to just go, well, just don't take the photos. Mm-hmm. But then also I think
that's
it
not
really
realistic.
Depends. No, it's not realistic. And also, what do we use photos for? And who? I mean, I've got about 10,000 photos on my phone, and who are they even taken for? And this is, they're not just nudies, they're all sorts of photos. And I think we need to consider who we're taking photos for. I think it's very personal. I think every single thing on my phone, I don't want anyone else looking at it. It's my personal little, you know, in Philip Pullman's his Dark Materials, everyone's got these little, they're called demons, like that go with
Harry Potter Patronus.
That's, that's like what I was
too.
yeah
but I did, do you know what I have to say, unfortunately, as somebody who's like, I'm definitely reckless by nature, and I've done lots and lots of stupid things. One thing I've not done is send nudes, really. I have maybe with like people that I've been with, but on a really rare occasion, and it takes a lot of you know, I've stopped myself from doing it.
Well, I've certainly not done it since I saw the picture being shown to people.
But Nelly, you say that you're like, that there's a kind of, there's a recklessness associated with sending it, that you said, but you still have sent it to like some people we've been in relationships with. And unfortunately, I mean, Rob Kardashian, he was, you know,
there's always risks. Yeah, there's always risks.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm lucky enough not to have
King. Yeah.
Yeah. That's an interesting, and who knows, like, you know, everybody's stayed over at somebody's house. Like, I don't know if someone's taken a picture of me. I have no idea those pictures.
Yeah.
I really hope not. But if you, I'm not condoning censorship. I just sleep easier at night knowing that
it's a person.
They've gone.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, completely. Yeah. Like, you shouldn't.
But you're no right. Of course. Like, somebody could pick up somebody else's phone.
Yeah.
Those images have air miles that we can't even conceive of. Like, do not, you know, play that down.
There's a really interesting study that came out really recently that said that women are more likely to send a sext or an explicit image of themselves if they're in a relationship, whereas men are more likely to do it when they're dating.
Oh, that's intriguing.
I mean, I don't know like how like great the study was, how big the sample size was, but that does seem pretty representative in my experience as well. But I think
don't think I've ever received a dick pic.
Oh, you're so
that's
lucky.
An invitation.
No, it really isn't.
Do not
slide
it
into
really,
DMs.
Really isn't. But I hear it happens a lot. I hear it happens a lot on dating apps.
I got sent one by an estate agent who had shown me a flat.
Sorry, we have a beep in the room. I think it's the dick pic siren. Someone receiving one right now.
The alarm.
Incoming phallus.
But it's a horrible thing to receive if you don't want it.
I don't know who does want them, to be honest.
Yeah, I don't know anyone. I mean,
I don't mind one if I've requested it.
Yeah.
But I think it's sometimes more difficult to take an artful erotic picture of a male body than a female one. I once received a very well-intentioned and requested dick pic from a beautiful man, but he positioned himself to the point where it was shot down his body, and it looked a lot like his big toe was growing out of his testicle. And once I'd seen that, I couldn't see anything sexual about it.
That's not a good angle for anyone.
It wasn't a great angle of dangle.
I have a friend who does send them, and he says he borrows another mobile phone and puts the torch on for lighting.
Excellent.
So it's
some phone is he borrowing?
I'm hoping
it's that sounds really
best friend.
Sounds really epic. Yeah.
Maybe he's got a ring light, a ding-a-ling ring light or something.
Like a Lumi.
Yeah. there's a gap in the market there. Dick pic lighting.
Yeah. I think it depends on how much people want to see dick pics as well. I think maybe there are people that, you know, there are people that definitely want to take them and send them, but maybe maybe that doesn't even matter about, yeah, whether people want to.
I do think as a society, we are going to have to become more forgiving of the fact that lots of people, recklessly or not, do choose to exchange visual and sexual matter within
relationships. I know my friends who are like 22 years old, I know if they saw a nude of any of their friends, I don't think they'd flinch. I think their reaction would be like, oh, great. She looks really great, or he looks really great, or like, you know, I really think it's become very normalised and that actually can be a positive thing.
I agree. I think we find ourselves in really interesting times, because you remember, you know, in politics particularly, it would be a scandal if a politician had taken drugs.
Anthony Weiner.
Yeah, exactly. Ever since.
I mean, that was
that was an exceptional.
That is, yeah.
Breach.
But I think when
decency.
Yeah.
A prolific. Anyway.
But when we get to the point when our generation is older than we are now, when we're in our 50s, we're all going to have stuff online.
Yeah.
Or on other people's phones.
There are things, all of our development as human beings is calcified and fossilized on the internet and through messages and on various social media platforms. It actually makes me quite sad these days when I hear these stories of people losing jobs because of something stupid they said on Twitter years ago, or people being turned down for positions or disrespected for their great politics or whatnot because of something in private becoming public. I think we are all going to have to accept that people do lead sexual lives. And that shouldn't be used as a slur upon them.
There was a recent kind of honey trap done of a Tory MP called Brooks Newmark. And it was what I found really insulting about that. Obviously, I did find it really a bit creepy that a supposedly family values MP had with five kids was, you know, and a wife was doing this. But then again, it's his personal life, but what I found really interesting is that the honey trap, I think it was done by The Sun, and I think it was a male journalist pretending to be a young woman, a young Tory campaigner, and it was the language that this guy was doing. He was effectively catfishing, and the language he was using to pretend to be this young girl was actually just quite, I found it really, really insulting, but I also found it insulting that this guy Brooks fell for it as well.
But I think the point that we are all sexual beings, and whether that's a taboo or something that society doesn't want us to talk about in public because it's meant to be part of your private life, I do think part of the digital revolution's legacy will be changing that.
Yes.
Because it is more public.
And obviously the focus of this conversation is dating, and dating's never been more public.
Yeah.
It's totally, like you're saying, it's crowdsourced. It's happening in public situations amongst groups of people. I often feel like when you start dating someone, you start dating their friendship group and their following. Like, really, really and truly.
Yeah, the first picture of you together, the Facebook official. Yeah.
And then the approval that it gets from everyone. Yeah. It's like people witnessing this birth of a new
relationship. We haven't really talked about that, have we?
This idea. We have run over.
Oh.
Because there's so much to talk about. Yeah.
So much.
I think that's testament to how interesting this is as an issue. Mm-hmm. I'm endlessly fascinated by it, so hopefully we'll get to talk about it again.
Yeah.
But thanks so much for sharing the stories,
thank you,
guys.
Thank you very much.
No, it's been lovely to chat about this. I'm just going to go and swipe frantically now.